Let's start talking about fear and how to use it to our advantage. So we are on page 125. We are flying, people. 125 of Mind Gym. Again, the best book of all time, if anybody asks. Let's start with a quote. Sam Snead, of all the hazards, he plays golf, of all the hazards, fear is the worst. Fear is the worst hazard. So it starts off the chapter talking about a fire department and how they basically recruit guys based on like a professional team. And it's guys that can do a challenge, but do it with like the most heightened circumstances that are going to join this team. So basically, for example, they say, if I were to tell you to stand up on a table that's on the ground, it's probably something you'd be like, yeah, I'd do that for sure. But if you tell that person, okay, now I need to do the same exact thing on a table that's 20 feet high in the air, what do? We get scared. We start thinking of all the things that could go wrong because the table is now 20 feet high. So that's basically how fear works. Fear is the mental response to a perceived danger or threat. So just like the table that's 20 feet high, we perceive all the things that could go wrong. That's why we get fearful. Fear is the worst hazard because it creates tension, doubts, and panic. Okay? Ever feel the last time you were fearful or doubtful? Actually, I had some fears yesterday. Let's be real. I think I have fears every day. And I doubt if there's tension or maybe a little bit of panic. Remember the last time you were fearful? Let's start turning it into something that we can use to help us. Awesome. Fear releases chemical hormones, this is like physically, that can inhibit performance and shut you down. Okay? That's like when you're fearful and you don't have words, it's because like you don't know what to say, you don't know what to do because you're scared. When you are afraid in sports, you start playing small. You kind of look small too. Do you see how I got little? Because you're focusing on the negative and you're worried about making mistakes. You're worried about the things that you cannot control and things that haven't even happened. But in your mind, you're like down or playing it to where you're probably going to screw up. All right. So a professional athlete, I'm still working at it, but I'm working to not let fear control me. Stop worrying about making a mistake. And how do we stop worrying about making a mistake? We do the opposite. If you guys saw my Instagram post yesterday, we have to think of the opposite of the mistake. So for example, you're on the field. So a mistake would be, let's say you're on defense, a ball goes through your legs, okay? That's a pretty big mistake, right? But here's the deal. If you focus on, you know, what's the best case scenario if a ball comes to me? Oh, I make a sweet play and I get that girl out. I get the girl out. So being able to focus on what it is that you want to do versus what you don't is how you can get out of the fear mindset and focus on the good. Fear is something we learn as kids. Give me some hearts if you can relate to this. A big coach might yell, "You screwed up again," or "How can you be so stupid?" Youngsters internalize these critical messages. From an early age, they would then develop fear of failure, a fear of doing the wrong thing. So I will tell you straight up, I had a coach in college. She was my coach for 2 years. I still talk to her today, but she made me fear to fail, all right? And she, whenever we did something wrong, we had some sort of a punishment. And I'm not saying that, you know, I'm not telling her how to coach, but I remember playing scared the majority of the time. Like if a ball came to me, a lot of times I was trying to get her my fear of failure because this coach was gonna like sit me on the bench if I don't make this play. I was scared about the result that hadn't even happened yet, but I'm like putting the worst case scenario into my brain. And because the worst case scenario was into my brain, therefore, if I was to have an error, that was why. And so I had to like internalize the fact that, okay, yes, we may have a punishment run if we lose this game. We may have a punishment run if I make an error, but here's the deal. I can't be scared of that. She taught me by the fact that I had fear to fail. She taught me that I had to be in control of my own thoughts. So for a while, I was fearful to make a mistake because I thought my coach was going to sit me or bench me, which she did at some points in time. So that's where I had to like figure out my own mental game because I had to deal with the fact that I had a coach that made me scared to fail. All right. So everybody might have had a coach that's made them fear to fail. But here's the deal. You're in control of your thoughts. You're in control of your mind. And this is how we're going to do that. So think about the Special Olympics. Okay. You don't have to watch it to know how special the Special Olympics is. Their motto is, "Let me win, but if I cannot win, let me be brave in the attempt." Coaches and volunteers provide what every athlete needs, encouragement and support. That's what the Special Olympics provides. Most Special Olympians, children and adults who are mentally challenged, have no fear of failure when they're running a 50-meter race or doing a long jump or throwing a shot put. Fear lives in the future. These athletes live in the present. The here and the now. Their participation is fun and it's rewarding. Special Olympians, they're not scared of what might happen. They're living in the present moment and they're making the most of every single moment. Amazing. Amazing. Fear is part of the process. We're always going to have fear, all right? Fact, we're always going to have fear, and it's part of the process. If you weren't scared, you'd be in trouble. A professional athlete said that because he uses fear as a tactic to bring out his best, and this is how you're going to do that. When you resist fear, you're only keeping it alive, okay? It's like trying to hold a beach ball underwater. The more you fight it, the more pressure you're building up, the more likely it is to fall. Athletes, you ready? Athletes should accept fear and recognize it as the body's way of telling them to become energized. I did. I remember doing a live and talking about butterflies, and I really wish I could tell you which episode it was. But if you go to my YouTube channel, I think it might have been called Fear of Failure or something. As soon as this is over, I'm going to find it. But it talks about how butterflies are necessary to bring out your best. If I didn't have butterflies before competing against top 10 opponents, I wouldn't have been able to thrive and be able to do really, really awesome performances in those situations because I used fear as energy, all right? Energy to see, you know what? You know, what am I here to lose? What is there to lose? I'm playing against UCLA. They don't even know who I am. Here's the opportunity for me to shine. So think about fear in that way. Fretting about the shot you just made will get you another just like it. So think about the game of softball. You hit a pop-up to the pitcher. Kind of embarrassing, right? Pop-up to the pitcher. That means you did not make a very good attempt on the last at-bat you had. But if you're scared to have that same result happen again, and you're only thinking about that last result that you had, what's likely to happen in your next at-bat? You're likely to do the exact same thing again because you can't get your focus off of the thing that you're scared of doing again. Okay, so they actually do an example of like someone playing golf, and not everybody here plays golf, I understand that, but it's the same exact thing. So the example they had in the book was if a guy shanks a shot, which by the way, shanking is not good in golf. Let's say they shank a shot and it's bad and like goes way right, out of bounds, whatever. If they're scared the next time they swing the club, they're scared to do the same thing again, and their whole focus and their mindset is trying not to do that thing again. Their focus is on that thing, which is therefore going to make the next swing probably look identical to the swing before. All right? The way we get over that fear is by focusing on the good, focusing on the positive. And I think it's funny that I put on Instagram literally this exact tactic that I'm sharing with you today, what you have to do to focus on getting away from the fear, getting away from the thing we don't want to do. So the way you do that is you focus on the thing that you do want to do. Okay, you focus on, okay, I want to rip this up the middle. Okay, what's it going to feel like? What's it going to look like? Play imagination in your head. This is what it's going to feel like. Let's make it happen. So this is actually goes along with the next thing I was going to say. Instead of just doing what I had done in practice 1,000 times, I worried about dropping the ball. So real life, we practice so we can create muscle memory. We practice so that we can get used to what it's like to do things well. Right? That's why we get a bunch of reps of ground balls in the game of softball. That's why we hit a ton of reps in the cages. We do that to create good muscle memory. And the way as a coach, I like to teach my players how to take those reps and really internalize those reps is we actually pause. So this is what I love to do. Whenever an athlete crushes a ball, like crushes, smokes it, like I can see it on their face. They were like, that was good. I have them pause right away and I have them write down that feeling. I have them write down the feeling of what that felt like, because here's the deal. In a game, we might forget what that feeling is like and therefore not have that swing in a game. And we want that really great swing to happen in the game for us, right? So the way that we do that is we internalize and we visualize and we feel what that swing was like, okay? And the whole goal for me in writing down things, you're 70% more likely to remember a thing if you write it down. So if you can get specific on, wow, my arms felt super loose and smooth, Wow, my legs, they just totally used the ground to help me drive into that ball. That pitch was in this location, doesn't matter where it is. But being able to be specific about that situation, you can then use that as a visualization tactic to say, you know what, I'm getting worked up right now. I'm nervous in this at bat. I don't know what the result's going to be, but you know what I can control? I can control my thoughts. I can control of taking that fear of failure to then saying, you know what, I was successful in this at bat in the cages with Ashley, or I was successful at home working with Dad, working on this exact same thing. I need to get myself in the shoes that I was in when that went well, and therefore my performance will then reenact the visualization, what I'm focusing on, which is the good. Okay, this might have been like the best thing that I've said so far on one of our Mind Gym Book Club mornings. I'm so glad you're here. Okay, lastly, many great athletes who use anger as a motivation also turn fear into an ally. So we also talked about Michael Jordan yesterday and about how he takes fear. So let's say the fear of, you know, losing, right, to an opponent, that's pretty good. He like makes up these stories to create anger in himself, which I shared this yesterday, but it's taking an opponent on the other side of the court and saying, you know what, he's out to get me. He might not actually be out to get him, but in his brain he is. So he uses that fear as like an anger tactic, which is motivation for him. That's motivation to be able to be his best on the court. So that's how he was able to take fear, turn it into anger, which then turned into some motivation for him. Some of the best athletes out there do it. Tiger also did it as well. Even Jen Schroeder, I worked with her with the package deal. It's ironic that I'm wearing this. She would always say, you know, at clinics that what motivated her was that she developed this fear as motivation that there's someone else on the other side of the country that's working, you know, as hard, if not harder than she is, to try to get that spot, starting spot at UCLA. So when she was growing up, she instilled the fear tactic of there's somebody else on another side of the country that's going to be working hard, but they're not going to work as hard as me. And that was her fear tactic. So she was like, you know what, if I want that starting spot, I have to be the only one in the country that's working the hardest to get it. So that was how she used fear as motivation. So lastly, I'm just going to end you guys with this. Don't let fear scare you. Feel the fear and do it anyway. Fear is often false evidence appearing real. False evidence that's appearing real. So when we have the fear, just like I started off today with, you know, standing on a desk. Let's say like someone tells you go stand on a desk. Okay, we can do that. It's easy. But then you put that desk 20 feet high and then you think of all the things that could go wrong, right? Nothing changes. The desk is the same size. The only difference is the fact that it's 20 feet higher. So if you fall, you're likely going to get hurt, right? So like we always think in our heads, the negative, the worst possible scenario. And that's what we do as athletes. We always think of the worst possible scenario. But remember, you can use fear as motivation. If you don't want a ball to go through your legs, you now know you have to focus on, okay, what's the best play I can make right now? And envision and visualize yourself doing that play and making that happen for you. So this is how we take our fears and we turn them into something good. Okay? Fear is motivation. I will tell you right now, what motivates me, and this is a fear tactic that motivates me, is I'm scared that too many athletes have to drive 2+ hours to a lesson. And this is why I developed online training. Hear me out. I used to drive in high school 2 hours to and from hitting lessons every single week. So actually, sorry, 2 hours to the lesson, 2 hours home. So 4 hours of driving every single week just for a hitting lesson. That's what I did as a family. And it was like worth it because that was the best coach that I could get my hands on. So it was absolutely worth it. But I'm scared that too many athletes are having to do that and they're sacrificing so much time, so much money, and so much energy doing that every single week. It took a lot out of me and my family to do that. And so the fear that I have as a coach now is that too many athletes are wasting so much time and money and energy on going to find the best hitting coach they can because there's no one close by. This is why I started online training. I am a hitting coach. I want to be able to work with athletes who don't have a prime hitting coach in their location. If you have to drive 2 hours to a lesson and 2 hours home, That scares me. I'm scared that too many athletes are having to do that, which is why I developed online training, because I want to be able to bring my skills as a coach to your home And this is what I started. I started this like a year ago, over a year ago. And now we're in a time where we're all hitting from home, which I think is crazy. But I started that with because of fear. I was fearful that too many athletes are having to do what I used to do. And I wanted to provide a solution. So that's why I hit with athletes in California right now, in New York City right now, in Chicago, actually down the street, but virtually because I can't meet with them yet. But that's why I started it out of fear. If I wasn't fearful that athletes are traveling across the country trying to figure out where the heck their next lesson's gonna be, that was fear. So I took that fear as motivation. Same thing with everything else that I've built. So my fear during this quarantine, for example, was that too many athletes are gonna be stuck at home and not have the tools that they needed to succeed. So I was fearful for athletes that didn't have that, so which made me use that as motivation. That was motivation for me to develop a $7 Goal Smasher course so that athletes would have the tools to be able to still work on your mental game and most importantly mental game, and work on your physical game. So 4 workouts are inside that course because I don't want a single excuse from an athlete saying, I don't have the tools that I need to still stay in shape or develop power. You have it in your hands with a $7 course. That's out of fear, I developed that course so that athletes can have what they need to still succeed from home. So I hope you guys are understanding that because of that fear that I have for athletes that don't have training from home, I built that course. Because I was fearful that athletes are trying to drive 4+ hours a week to lessons, because of that fear that I have, I used to do that every single week. I don't even know how the heck I did that. Now they have access to hit with an elite coach from home. So out of that fear, that's why I created that. Out of that fear, that's why I created these lessons, the $7 Goal Smasher course. Out of fear that athletes don't have a great hitting coach from home, that's why I'm doing lessons inside of a membership where there's all the hitting drills that I could even think of are inside there, because I think too many athletes don't have access or don't think they have access to things. And that's why I do what I do. I needed kind of a little reminder today of why I do what I do, and that was it. So exactly from this book, fear is what motivates me. Fear is what can motivate you as well, only using it in the right way. So I definitely talked about this a lot longer than I had planned, but remember, it's okay to have fear. We just have to use it to our advantage and use it as our own motivation. Okay, so tomorrow, this is where I'm gonna end. Tomorrow we're talking about breathing. Okay, so being able to, let's say before a big at bat, focus on your breath and get the results that you're looking for. So breathe and focus is what we're gonna start with tomorrow at 10. So meet me here tomorrow at 10, and we're gonna be on page 130 on the chapter breathe and focus. I want to say this because Travis just commented, highest mountain as a softball parent is getting my athlete to let go of her fear of letting down mom and dad. Wow. So Travis, this is exactly why I'm starting a podcast. This is exactly why I plan to interview my dad and my mom and to have them share our journey of growing up, because my dad was my coach growing up. My dad was always the one hitting in the backyard with me. He was the one who took me to those lessons all the way across the country and back home. I'm starting a podcast basically for parents and players to understand. And I'm not saying our relationship was perfect, but I want, and a lot of people ask me what our relationship was like. How did he get me to go play D1 softball and then professionally? How did my middle sister, Christina, get to UNC to play softball? How did my little sister, Anna, she's playing college volleyball? Like, I think it's really, really important for athletes to understand, athletes and parents to understand what it's like to be able to get to the next level. And I'm glad you said that, Travis, because for a majority of my career, and I will say this in the podcast, was trying to please my dad. Majority of my career, I was trying to please my dad. And I remember there was a setback, and I've shared this before, but I'm gonna share it again. There was a setback that I had, and I think it was in college, where that at bat was when I broke a record. I broke a record after that at bat. And after the game, my dad was there, and I told my dad, or after the game, I was just like, Dad, that was for you. And my dad looked like he wanted to punch me in the face. He was like, you broke a record for me? Why would you want to do that for me? That sounds ridiculous. Do it for yourself. Do it for you. And you are literally saying the same thing right there that my dad told me, but it took me until I was in college to understand that. So if I can get people to understand that, you know, a lot of athletes, they do try to work for their parents and for their parents to approve of them. I was the same way. And I had to learn that this journey, they were helping me with it, but it was my journey. It was me taking ownership of my goals. I'm in charge of them. My dad, yes, my parents sacrificed so much time and money to get me to where I wanted to be, but it was my job and my love for the game that helped make that happen. And their help helped me get there, but I was in charge of my dream. I was in charge of my goals. Those records that I broke were yes, my parents helped me get there, but that was something that I did. I made that happen. And my dad had to remind me that I'm in charge of that. I did that. He didn't do that. So he was mad that I said to him, I was just like, Dad, that was for you. And he was just like, what? Why would you ever do that for me? Do it for you. And like that conversation was exactly what I needed to hear. To then like my game took a whole nother level after that because I realized this is me. This is what I'm in charge of. I'm in charge of my goals. I'm in charge of seeing how far I get in this game.